Hello and welcome to the Worst Movie Ever Made, an experimental movie podcast designed with one thing in mind, to find the worst movie ever made. I'm your host, Chris Ackman. I'm joined by my co-host and fellow mad scientist, Rob Scucci and Bob Hasick. This at least has to be the worst musical ever made on film. How are you guys doing?
I am feeling Jellicle and wondiferous and rum-tum tumultuous in my stomach because we watched this movie and I broke my vape on the counter by accident, so I have no way to cope. Bob?
Yeah, I don't know. I'm doing all right. But why are we doing this? I'm not really sure. So have you heard of the anthropomorphic people?
Like the furries?
Yes. Yeah, I think they, if they're really into ballet and musical theater, they would like lose their mind over this movie. Otherwise, the rest of us are just left in the dark. I don't know.
Yeah, I didn't, just because I know what fact or no fact kind of stuff you'd be doing, but I stayed away. I really wanted to Google like what was the furry reaction to cats.
I didn't
and
look it up.
I washed my hands of it. I will look into it later, or maybe during the show. We'll find out. I imagine cum puddles galore, or rumper cum pums, or whatever they want to call them.
Little milk saucers full.
Oh, gross.
Off to a great start.
YouTube comments.
Sure. I got five. I've been doing five. That's a good number. I hate how all the dancing is kind of pretty and good, but I have to watch a bunch of literal sleep paralysis demons do it. Number two, while this opening number really isn't that bad, if the whole movie was fun like this, instead of having horrifying things like cockroaches with human faces, I'd watch it tomorrow. McCavity is an absolute legend. His facial expressions speak for the whole audience. It genuinely makes me sad how much potential this movie could have had. Just watching Shimpleshank's part confirms that. Just how objective that comment is with the name Shimpleshank.
And I think they got it wrong.
Probably. Yeah. This is art and people still can't appreciate that this is a legendary musical. The effort of the actors and actresses was really good and hard. They sang live while recording. They didn't. Cats look weird, but come on, see farther than that. No.
Ouch.
No, I can't see farther than that. Good point, Rob. Immediately, it's off-putting.
Yeah.
But, you know, let's see how it compares to its competition in test number one, the worst of its kind.
Is this film the best of the worst or the worst of its kind?
Okay. Once again, I promise I was not at all selective just out of pure hatred for the movie.
Okay.
I promise. Okay.
Okay.
And I'll prove it to you, because the first is The Princess and the Frog with Anika Nani Rose, who I think is the lead actress and singer. And if that is so, it would be as incredible. Came in at 85%.
Okay.
Way to go, Disney. But again, we're not so sure about Disney anymore. Disney and Rotten Tomatoes and their affiliation.
Yep.
Whatever it is. Speaking of which, A Nightmare Before Christmas. That is a classic.
Yeah.
I think most people agree that Catherine O'Hara from Home Alone was great. And so was Danny Elfman. Last time we brought him up, I said Danny Elfman, so I went with Catherine O'Hara. 95%.
Yeah.
Yep.
Labyrinth, Rob, with David Bowie.
Oh, hell yeah.
Oh, yeah. Childhood favorite.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, it actually was the weakest of the five with a 75. That's still a strong score, but...
Fun fact, that's why my daughter is named Bowie, because David Bowie from Labyrinth was Stacey's first crush. So whenever I see my daughter, I see that man's face.
That's what everyone wants to see when they look at their daughter, a man's face.
Exactly.
Have you guys seen Onward, the Disney movie?
No.
No, never.
Okay, well, it got an 88. It's Tom Holland and Chris Pratt. Yeah, what movie doesn't have those two in it these days? But it's actually really good. Just saying, objectively, I won't get into what it's about or anything, but why don't we finish off the Disney, let's see, what is it, a quadfecta? Frozen.
Sure.
With Kristen Bell.
Yeah.
Yes, I know, but you gotta take the first five you see, and
yep.
That came in with a 90. So,
right.
A stunning average of 86.6%. Ooh, sorry, Cats.
Yeah.
What do you think Cats came in with, guys?
15.
Yeah, based on the reviews, I'd say close to 20.
You guys nearly hit it on the head, the both of you. It came in with a 19.
Right.
Oh.
which I think is deserving. I think
yeah.
19 points too many. So the difference between the average and cats is negative 67.6.
Oh, jeez.
Which I think it deserves.
I want to tell you guys something. Based on what I'm picking for the polls and how they're ranking, I'm trying to seal a dynasty over here with with my picks of just absolutely worst ranking movies.
Yeah. Well, you've won a couple of championships of late, and the people are starting to hate you for it, I think.
Yeah, I hate myself, so fuck off.
Yeah.
But this one fits the bill. It was supposed to be huge.
It was. I mean, that's what we want is movies that were supposed to be amazing and flopped hard. And this was a definitely one of those. It was also worst of its kind. So we have that jotted down. Why don't we throw it to test number two? I assume a limerick again for Ain't That a Pitch. Yeah.
I got an idea for a movie and hit my pitch. I get a job and quit my band and you stop being a bitch.
Ain't that a
Well, I guess right. I did discuss this with you guys earlier because I said mine is basically nonsensical.
Yeah.
But I compared it to Cats.
Okay.
Very, very wordy. Do you want me to just go for it?
Go for it.
Go for it.
It's impact indelible. Content unintelligible. Like I was on edibles or a big batch of fentanyl. Fat jokes on cats like Shat with a splat. Each time I heard Jellicle, punched myself in the testicle.
All right. Good.
That was kind of like a limerick.
A little bit.
Yeah, not really. It was actually limerick form. I just went for the double rhyme each line just to stuff it in as much as I could, like the writers of Cats.
Yeah.
All right. We shared a rhyme, so I'm going to go next.
Okay.
Is it Jellicle?
Yes, it is. There once were some cats who were Jellicle, whatever that means, which is parenthetical. Lots of cats will sing and dance. Some wear shoes and some wear pants. My memory of this movie is likely indelible.
Wow. Look at that. We both used indelible as well.
Yeah. We did.
There once was a Broadway play with a legacy that's here to stay. Then they shot a new movie, and to our horror, it was poopy. Make sure that your felines are spayed.
Agreed, because I'm allergic to cats, literally.
Yeah.
Who are we giving the credit to here?
I like Chris's multiple rhymes, and so I'll go.
I like Chris too.
Okay, guys, I'm not going to argue. I was going to give it to me too.
Cool.
What's the star grade?
Four.
Four or five. So 4.25.
Okay, got it. All right, so that's pretty strong. Let's see how it compares to Hocus Pocus 2. Oh, look at that. I didn't write it down. What an idiot. Okay.
Loser.
So I'm just going to write 4.25 star, and then on our first clip, I'm going to run upstairs while no one knows. All
right.
And we'll see how it compares later.
All right,
test number three, the worst dialogue.
This is not the greatest dialogue in the world, no. This is just
some bullshit. Right.
Like so many before it, there was not a whole lot of actual dialogue between songs. So I had to kind of pull from songs and, you know, sort of go with concepts instead of straight lines. I hope you bear with me.
When I was pirating it, I didn't even know I got a French version because all the songs were in English.
Yeah. Yeah. It took like 10 minutes to realize.
Yeah.
I think the first thing that happens is a song, right?
Yep. Yeah. Jellicles.
Yeah. starting with number 10, and this was Taylor Swift's character. I didn't bother to look her up. The orange one that sings with a catnip and chip, I think.
Yeah. Right.
Well, the main line, the tagline of the chorus is, when a crime is discovered, McCavity's not there. Just kind of a backwards line. It's also insinuating that he committed the crime and isn't there to be caught while they're pitching that he should be the Jellicle choice. Kind of backwards. I don't really understand this movie at all. I think this is a good light version of that. You know, this is like a kind of backwards speak that makes no sense given what you're going for. And unless you guys have something to say about it, I'll jump right to number nine. As you can imagine, I have a capital C-A-T catch-all that is to rival no other. It is incredible. So I'm just going to keep pushing.
All right.
Go.
Penny Dancer, whatever her name is. Rebel Wilson? Is it Rebel?
Sure.
Yes.
The blonde?
Yes.
She's talking to her Beatles about their performance, and she says, "Don't get cocky," which was obviously a pun on the fact that this nice house is flooded with cockroaches.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You'll notice a theme throughout the worst dialogue. Bad puns will reemerge.
Yes.
Oh, good.
Number eight. I just went with, like, we've kind of already opened up this dialogue. I know I did it in Ain't That a Pitch, but if you guys feel like you want to talk about it a little bit. Number eight, I simply wrote Jellicle Cats.
when you're walking alone with Jellicle Cat.
It could have been number one, honestly, because the number of times that they said Jellicle.
Yeah.
I looked. Did anybody else look up and try to see how many times the word was actually said in the movie?
Yes. No, I did. Yes.
Did you find it?
128.
That's it.
That's Chris. That's more than once per minute.
That's more. That's more than John Travolta said leverage in Battlefield Earth.
That can't be true.
Like, 100%. Think about all the times they're. Think about all the times they're just dancing. Think about the Memories song where they don't say it once. You know what I mean? So yeah. They must jam it in the rest of the time.
Yeah, they jam it in, all right. That's true.
In the Jellicles. I'm writing that down.
Jamming it in my testicles, as I alluded to before, because I just kept punching myself in the balls every time they said it.
Yeah.
That's my story. I'm sticking to it. Why don't we throw it to our first clip of the night? This one almost rhymes. How about Magical?
The loof. You would think there was nobody shyer, but my voice has been heard on the roof when I was curled up by the fire. And I've sometimes been heard by the fire when I was about on the roof. At least they all heard that somebody purred, which is incontestable proof of my singular magical powers. And I've known the family to call me in from the garden for hours. When I was asleep in the hall. And not long ago, this phenomenal cat produced 7 kittens right out of a hat.
Mr. Mistopheles, my hero.
Oh,
no, girl. Oh, it's falling.
And they all say, oh, well, I never was there ever. A cat so clever as magical is.
One thing to this film's credit, and I think it just might be a Broadway thing, the bass guitar goes off on every fucking song.
All right.
Like, all right. It's like top-notch musicianship. Like, it's good. It's just objectively good.
Yeah, give it to Andrew Lloyd Webber. But then again, I think he writes only the lyrics, so I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know, but good job hitting them with a little honey before I send in the vinegar. he says that he was on the roof, like, doing magic or something, or talking or sleeping by the fire, and then by the fire he was on the roof, and then he was in the hallway when they called him in from the garden for 3 hours, and that's incontestable proof of the fact that he's magical, and then he pulled 7 cats out of his head, and then he started singing about himself again.
Yeah.
I hate this. Movie number 6, Penny. Oh no, look what the cat dragged in. I don't remember when that happened. I don't care. It's another terrible one of these fucking stupid cat puns. I hate this movie.
Yep.
Number 5, it's a clip. This one's called Ineffable.
Good one.
The past experience revived in the meaning is not the experience of one life only. But of many generations, not forgetting something that is probably quite ineffable.
Rob, what was the joke? Remember when I said whether something could be like on or off? You know, like there's only one option.
So, there was one time, yeah, so we were working together, and you said something. I said, actually, quite the opposite. And then like 2 hours go by and then you say, hey, Rob, you could say that opposites are an absolute, right? And then I said yes. And he had, then you could see why it's a bit superfluous to use the word quite as a qualifier, you fucking idiot. And then you walk away.
Yeah. Okay, so I feel like the same way here because she says something quite ineffable, which is like, if it's inevitable, it's ineffable. It is ineffable. God. It is something that you can't describe, right?
Yeah.
You can't probably quite not describe it, right?
Yeah.
I'm feeling the same way here, though. Light switch is on or off. It's ineffable or it isn't.
Yeah.
But worse than that, I know she's an old cat.
Yeah.
What was she singing? Was that singing?
No, it was like crooning, like Phoebe Bridgers or like Cat Power.
It was like cancer. It was like a church cancer.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I mean, I think we've said enough on that clip. If this movie isn't aggravating you already, then I don't know what's wrong with you, and I hate you too.
Yeah.
Number four, Monkastrap. I think that's his name, right? He's like the lead cat of the Jellicles, like in the streets.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He says to Victoria, "So what's your name? Cat got your tongue?" There you go. Another really clever cat pun.
Yep.
Imagine if we were just calling our, like, just saying, like, oh, humans break your leg when you go out on stage or, like, you know, shit like that.
Yeah.
I also looked up how many times the word cat or cats was said.
Ooh.
It was 160.
Wow.
So Jellicles is actually up there with just the word cat. Cool, because Jellicle cat. Yeah,
well, yeah, right. most Jellicles were followed by cat.
Yeah,
but I take Chris's point and I run with it because why would you say your species so many damn times?
Yeah,
unless they hammer it into the audience, you know, you have, which they establish at the end.
Idiots,
right? Apparently, what I read, I never saw the musical, even though I had the soundtrack. apparently, they break the fourth wall many times throughout the musical. And they talk to the audience, but in the movie, in the movie, they just did it at the end,
the very end. Yeah. Well, I want to say that I'm going to protect myself from that. I feel like there might be one other time in the catch-all where I mentioned that they break the fourth wall, but I might not. So I'm just throwing out a qualifier. Maybe it's not literally the only time.
Yeah.
all right. Another clip. This one is called Puss and Spats. Okay. I think.
Used to be going to the ball.
Oh no, you're not going anywhere, Puss and Spats. I'm determined to win, and I prefer my competition chained up.
Growl, Tiger. Keep him here. Meow.
He's called me that twice now, Puss and Spats. Like it's sort of a joke, and I rather like it. So the joke's on him.
What is Puss and Spats?
I know Puss in Boots. Is it like a play on that?
Yeah, I guess Puss in Spats. Spat.
The only reason I know about Puss in Boots is because a comic drawer named Jay Grant had, because it's phonetically Puss in Boots, and he drew just two boots overflowing with pus, and he called it Puss in Boots.
I don't know. Maybe some of our listeners over there in London town can choose an email. That's where this takes place. Yes,
theworstmovieevermade.com. Yes, it is where it takes place.
Correct.
So maybe spats is like a thing that overweight people or wear. I don't know. Maybe they're like a muumuu or something. I have no idea. That's my best guess.
I'm trying to go through all the Morrissey lyrics, and I know he broke into the palace with a sponge and a rusty spanner. But I don't know about Puss and Spats.
I think I've seen some bad movies where they spats on puss.
Yeah. Indeed.
All right. Well, I was going to talk about the whole Growl Tiger name and how bad that is, but we have plenty of time to talk about all the terrible names. These like super high people. Number two, this is Penny again. She's talking, of course, about Rum Tum Tugger and his singing style. And she says, "Nudud, maybe because those notes are so high, And then she does the snip, snip, snip thing to, like, insinuate that he's had his balls cut off. Here's a question that I should never ask. Can you see a normal cat's balls?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yes, you can. I hear there's a version of this movie where you can see the cat's buttholes. Is that true?
Yes. It's on record. It's not like an Urban Dictionary or like a Snopes thing. Like it. In the early iterations, the EFX people that were like doing the dailies were like horrified to find out there were buttholes exposed. And they went back and they edited them out in post.
Imagine what the furry crowd would be doing with that.
Wow.
Yeah.
So there is a version with genitalia.
Rum cum cubbles. Bubbles.
Rum tum tugger, indeed. but yeah, nothing that what's her face, Rebel Wilson has ever done has made me laugh. But leaning into her style of comedy the way they did was another bad choice, in my opinion. Okay, number one after the drum roll. Pure shit.
Keeping it objective, we see.
Don't mess with the crazy cat lady.
Fire for Figure!
The fiend of the fence.
Yeah.
What does he say there? Any idea?
I don't know. I had no captions idea. And I don't remember.
I didn't have captions. So I had to guess and I didn't because I had literally no idea. Okay, I'm going to skip what I want to say now and just go to the fact that she makes the cat lady pun. Which is not... It doesn't work. Then James Corden shoots a hairball on him as an offensive maneuver. And then Growl Tiger falls into the river after Ian McKellen does the performative hiss, I suppose. And then he says something unintelligible. And it was extremely awkward at that. I hope the YouTube audience appreciates the clips because seeing it visually is going to add a little element here.
Yeah.
Which that can be said on the whole. If you haven't seen Cats, what was it, 2017?
19.
Okay. If you haven't seen it, I'm not saying you should. I'm not saying you should get a bootleg version. Just Google image it. Just take a look at the faces on these cats. It's really something. And I'm probably going to take to Google just to see a little cat butthole at the end.
A little butthole, yeah.
You know, as soon as this is over, because I got to know.
Yeah.
With that said, I'm going to check my phone real quick while we throw it to test number four. The worst production. Just kidding.
The worst production.
The worst production.
This was a horrible production, and I was torn between three things. So I'm really not sure which one I want to go with. So, but I'm gonna go back to what Chris said about the cat puns. They don't work. But that kind of piggybacks onto another thing, where anytime they left the source material, like anytime anytime they left the source material and made castration jokes or made cat lady jokes or made hairball jokes, none of it landed. And anytime a movie is that committed to the source material but then decide to throw movie things in, like that, how many nut shots were there? Like two nut shots in this movie?
There were a couple nut shots.
Like all that stuff was just unnecessary addition. And I'm pretty sure, but also I'm going to say my original one was too much CGI.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That I'm torn between those two things.
They didn't need the CGI in the cat costumes. They could have just had like just some good latex and practical.
Yeah. So rumor has it that the director put like an enormous pressure on the CGI team. Like basically saying like you gotta overdo this movie to my specifications and it has to be done by this deadline. So a lot of them were actually sleeping under their desks because they were working around the clock.
I don't really understand how he thought that would work anyway, though, because the scale isn't even right. Like the scale of the sets makes cats larger than they actually are, though.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like a cat does. Okay, so I'm kind of ruining a catch-all here, but like cats are not bipedal, so the cat's height is, you know, a time and a half what it would normally be to scale on the set. So they're like, I don't know if they were saying like sit on like, you know, crawl on all fours and then we'll scale it out. We'll take a picture and then have them walk on 2 feet the entire time or what?
And to that point. To that point, correct me if I'm wrong, I don't think they ever mentioned what a Jellicle was. Maybe it's its own species that can be bipedal and disproportionate.
They give some kind of really super like quarter-hearted explanation, I think, in the Jellicle cat song. But what that explanation is, I couldn't tell you. Maybe I'm just thinking about them explaining why they have three different names.
Yeah.
Which is really only two different names, which is really only one.
Yeah.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
So, Bob, is it too much CGI or is it the breaking from source material or what?
If I'm going with production, I'll go with the CGI just because I feel bad for that department that had
to. I agree.
Like, when I read about the movie, they said that was generally the downfall of this production was the CGI team was at such odds with the director.
And then I think the source material would be a good demerit should it come to a tiebreak.
Ooh, good point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like that, Rob. Good thinking. Okay. Source divergence. Okay. I like it because, you know, last thing on the CGI, but it really is just off-putting.
Yeah.
You know, like immediately I don't want to look at it. So... Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's a really bad start.
Yeah.
Okay, Rob, why don't you give us your phenomenal ad read?
Yes.
He just freezes. What bad timing is that?
I thought it was me. For once.
Rob, tell me you're just holding that face. That would be phenomenal.
The dogs were great. That's but you so had fun. Five of them and you ran out of Pepcid. Uh-oh. Fast forward to bedtime. Cold sweats, sleep paralysis. The Hat Man is standing in the doorway, but your screams aren't being heard reverberating through the guest room and into the hallway, but rather into a shadowland beyond the realm of your comprehension. Grilled hot dogs at 3 p.m. You'll be gone a long time.
Rob, I wish I heard that whole thing. You froze in the beginning.
Did I freeze?
Yeah.
Oh. Maybe I'll just read it over, and then I'll fix it in post.
Yeah, just cut out the first part.
Today's episode of The Worst Movie Ever Made is brought to you by a sister company to microwave hot dogs at 3 a.m. Grilled hot dogs at 3 p.m. Nothing exciting here. You're chilling with the family, you're having fun, playing by the pool, trick-or-treating with the kids after dinner time. The dogs were great, but you had to have five of them, and you ran out of Pepcid. Uh-oh. Fast forward to bedtime, cold sweats, sleep paralysis, the Hat Man standing in the doorway, but your screams aren't being heard reverberating through the guest room and into the hallway, but rather into a shadowland beyond the realm of your comprehension. Grilled hot dogs at 3 p.m., you'll be gone a long time. that better?
That was
better. That was perfect, yeah.
Okay.
Loud and clear.
All right.
You know, you're turning me off from hot dogs altogether, which I'm sad.
I like them even more.
Oh, you do?
Yeah, I like riding the melt, dude. It just takes you where you need to go.
Yeah, I just hate being reminded of the Hat Man. You know?
You know what I'm talking about? Everybody who takes too much Benadryl ends up seeing the Hat Man. You know that's like a thing, right?
Yeah, everybody knows that.
Okay.
All right, test number five, the most expensive.
Cool.
Don't call me faggot, you!
Eric, did you just say the F word?
Yeah!
All right.
All right, let's start it off the right way. We've all mentioned this numerous times already in this first half hour, but Jellicle cats.
Mm-hmm.
How much can you shove that into my butt before I explode? Honestly.
Are you a BoJack Horseman fan?
No, my sister is.
Okay, so BoJack, and like I've only seen the first season. I got to catch up, but his ex-girlfriend is like a cat, and she's an agent. And whenever he calls her, she puts him on hold, and you hear, "When you're walking alone with Jellicle cat." And it's like 5 hours later, and he's just still sitting on the phone, and that song's playing.
Yeah, that's this movie.
Yeah.
Yep.
Cats are largely nudists, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, largely, yes.
Okay, because some choose to wear clothes.
Yeah.
In some very confusing situations, but that suggests that the ones that don't are letting it fly because they, like alligators or something, do not have genitals outside the body.
Yeah.
I guess not.
I don't know. Number three, just to tag along, sexy cats.
Yeah.
Not a fan of sexy cats.
Michelle Pfeiffer, Batman Returns.
Okay, that's a sexy cat I can get down with. Good. Okay. Point.
That's a cat woman.
Yeah, it's a cat, well, not a woman cat.
Not a Jellicle cat.
Right.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Four, and this is before I go on my literation joke thing, but number four, okay. Fat jokes.
Yeah.
Come on. Kind of in line with what Bob was saying. You know, there's like raunchy, shitty humor in here that doesn't belong, and the fat jokes are far too common, in my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
like hey, let's cast James Corden and Rebel Wilson to be the new Kevin James and Melissa McCarthy's the next generation. Those guys, you know?
Mike and Molly, Paul Blart. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah, just, like, exactly. I hate that kind of stuff. I never thought it was funny.
Mm-mm. No.
Okay, here we go. Number five, eating insects and forced to entertain.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, she just, and mice too, I would imagine, but she forces these little creatures into slavery and then eats them if she so chooses. Not even as punishment, just at her behest.
This just reminds me, though, be glad I didn't pick Joe's apartment for a movie.
Oh, I love, you guys know what I'm... I love it. I love the soundtrack.
Okay.
I don't know what it is.
Just don't bother.
All right. Okay. That's my pick for next week.
No. I better win next week.
Yeah.
Although I think I'm going with Son of the Mask.
Oh, God.
We'll talk off air, but I want to do Rocket Man 1997. Well, moving on.
Excommunicating Isabella extremely unethically.
Yeah.
What did she do?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Like, cats can't be homeless, but, like, she's as close as you can be, right?
Yeah.
Like, all the cats are kind of homeless. Because cats are inside-outside animals, you know?
Yeah.
But they just, like...
I don't get that.
No, I don't get it either, and I feel like it's immoral. All right, this one's for you, Rob. I left it for last. Okay. Oh, no, I didn't. I will, though. How about that? I'll skip it.
Sure.
Cat orgy vibes in the moonlight.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Real weird. Cat nipping a cat crowd for compliance.
Yeah.
So I have a connection to that one. Not connection, but so you know how Taylor Swift came down on the moon and and then sprinkled catnip? Apparently... you ever heard of Studio 54, the nightclub?
Yeah. Yes.
So apparently there was a device shaped like a crescent moon that somebody would come down on with a Coke spoon.
Yep.
And wow. let people sniff off it.
That's actually that's one movie that Mike Myers had like a somewhat dramatic role in that was actually pretty good from what I
remember. Studio 54?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I've heard all the stories. I haven't seen the movie.
The movie made me feel ill because it was just so, ugh.
It's indulgent. It's like, yeah.
Yeah, it's like ancient Rome partying.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But anyway, that's that's what I heard that scene was inspired by, but I don't know if that was from the musical or if that was just for the movie.
Gotcha.
Yeah, I don't know either, because I haven't seen the musical, and I will not.
No.
Yeah, I will not.
Okay, I saved this one for last. I think I might get Rob here. We'll see.
Okay.
Birthday suit, Bustopher, gargling back alley glizzies.
Birthday suit, Bustopher.
Gargling back alley glizzies.
Gargling back alley glizzies. Okay, got it.
Yeah, they strip him nude just before he goes like dumpster diving, and he gives it a oh like
yeah
like, yeah get yeah. these clothes off of me,
yeah.
Which is why the introduction of clothes in the first place was a bad idea.
Yeah.
Yep.
It just brings about a whole lot of questions, you know.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything? Any other mentions?
No.
No. No mentions.
Okay, test number 6, the worst acting.
What you just said is one of the most insanely idiotic things I have ever heard. At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought. Everyone in this room is now dumber for having listened to it. I award you no points, and may God have mercy on your soul.
Okay, first clip for worst acting is one called Name.
You may think at first I'm as mad as a hatter when I tell you a cat must have 3 different names. First of all, it's the name that the family use daily, such as
Peter, Augustus,
Alonzo,
or James.
But I tell you, a cat needs a name that's particular, a name that's peculiar. And more dignified.
Else how can he keep up his tail perpendicular,
or spread out his whiskers,
or cherish his pride?
But above and beyond, there's still one name left over.
And that's the name that you never will guess.
The name that no human research can discover, but the cat herself knows and will never confess.
When you notice the cat
in profound meditation,
the reason
I tell you is always the same. The mind is engaged in rapt contemplation of the thought. Of the thought. Of the thought. Of her name. Ineffable. Ineffable.
Cool.
So I like we spelled out before, they say that you should have a peculiar, strange name only known to you that you make known to everyone else.
Yeah.
That works.
Yeah.
I guess. Well,
I have a major contention with that when we get to the catch-all. But also, larger point, it's a musical, you have to give them musical performance.
Yeah.
You know, you have to let it ride a little bit, but
yeah.
That was not a musical number,
no.
In my estimation, correct?
No, I would call it. I would consider it a song. I think if on production, they would refer to that as a song, but I don't think, my sensibilities, I would not consider it one.
Okay,
it's the way rap is a song. It's not sung, but it's still a song.
Yeah. Okay, well, my contention doesn't actually matter. My contention is that the performances, the dancing, the singing from each of the cats, backed up by the backup dancers and singers behind them,
yep.
might have been practiced before. It would seem like a really boring life to do that every night if you're a Jellicle cat. You just meet up at Rebel Wilson's house and do the number again for the time that you can show it to a new cat who happens in a back alley.
Yeah.
But if you don't know that there is a cat showing up in the back alley and you're just doing like the musical number for your own entertainment, then this would not be something that you would ever practice. The explanation of why a Jellicle cat has a name, unless they're taking in strays that aren't Jellicle all the time.
You've
like they shouldn't be practicing the explanation unless there's an audience, right?
you put way too much thought into this that
way
I would.
You have no.
I feel idea. Bad for you.
Wait until we get to the catch-all. That's all I'm saying. I have gone deeper into this piece of shit than I've ever put my finger in.
This movie's in the league for me where you just lay back and let it happen to you, and you just don't. You let it wash over you like a warm ocean wave.
Hey, this is what I do. This is why we are movie critics. It's thanks to me breaking down movies like this. All right. So allow me my indulgences.
Okay.
Very actually don't it. Because if you very, allow me to keep going, it's going to be a 4-hour podcast.
Very
so.
Bust. That's very bustiferous of you, Chris.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm just trying to. Anyway, that's my main contention with that. It feels like something they shouldn't be saying to anyone because it's we hate exposition.
Yeah,
and this is expository.
It is. It's early. Yeah. That's why.
Yeah. But. Okay, I'm just gonna leave that alone, and we're gonna move over to clip number two, Bustopher Jones.
It's not a moment to say, oh, God! Oh, too drunk in for a drink at the Drones. Thanks, Tugger. When I'm seen in a hurry. There's probably curry at the Siamese or at the Glutton. If I look full of gloom, then I've lunched at the Tomb on cabbage, rice pudding, and mutton.
The whole of St. James is the smartest of names. It's the name of this bramble and cat. And we're all of us proud to be nodding about.
Bustopher Jones in white.
So much in this way.
Have you ever found yourself in a situation where you'd rather listen to Captain Beefheart?
Than Beefheart?
Captain Beefheart.
Captain Beefheart. He has an album called Trout.
Oh, you showed me that.
Trout Mask Replica.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would rather listen to Trout Mask Replica at full volume than watch this again.
I would rather, I think. Yeah. Is it shorter?
No, it's probably longer. It's like 78 minutes, I think.
I'd still rather listen to that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think James Corbin's performance there. I don't know. How do you judge something like this? I never knew where to pull bad acting clips because it's all bad and it's all what they wanted, I think.
Yeah.
Right?
It's hard to fault them because, like, if that's the choreography they were given and they're singing on point, they're probably using some studio enhancement or whatever, but, like,
sure.
They're nailing their parts. It's just
I guess. I mean, most of that segment had to be CGI. He was flopping all over the place.
Yeah.
Yeah. And one particular instance that bothered me a lot was when he's singing and drinking.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like we've all seen the cereal milk clip.
Yeah.
Rob, you know the one where that's what happens. That's what happens if people pour into your throat while you're laying down.
You're saying this is like a ventriloquist act, so someone's drinking the water and their hand's up the cat's ass.
Yeah. Okay. It just dawned on me that that's not possible because they don't have assholes.
Yeah, they remove them. Fuck. Okay.
All right. Now, this one really better get under your skin, and I'm talking to everyone, not just us. This one's called Not a Dog.
You've heard of several kinds of cat, and my opinion now is that you should need no interpreter to understand our character. You've learnt enough to take the view the cats are very much like you. You've seen us both at work and games, and learnt about our proper names, our habits, and our habitat. But how would you address a cat? your memory I'll jog and say a cat is not a dog. So
what are they thinking there? Is that another one of these like cat jokes?
It sounds like that was the original song. That's what makes it so sad.
Yeah,
like, I just don't understand the point that I feel like they should have established at some point their true hatred for dogs for that joke to land.
I guess.
Yeah. I don't know. I'm deeply disturbed by this movie.
that's the ending sort of crescendo there. Yeah. All of the cats come together in the sunlight to see Jennifer Hudson's character off into the sunlight, and that's what they're singing to really drive it home. Yeah.
Yep.
Okay.
I feel like Clockwork Orange. I feel like this is exactly what they were showing. What's his name with his eyes?
Alex. Yeah.
Yeah. Seriously. Had this like, been out then.
The ultraviolet.
Yeah.
Yeah. That actually should have been my trailer. It should have been cutting back and forth between him and.
And then
we can still do it. We can still do it.
Maybe I'll do
just
that for
a
the
reminder.
Next one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fact or no fact?
Okay. Oh, I need to go to this page. There we go.
The worst movie ever made presents Fact or No Fact.
I gotta put my microphone down to type Bob's stuff because I'm traveling light this week.
Traveling light. I called Fact or No Fact Shats this week. Just because cats. So there was a request put in by your other hosts. Well, at least Chris didn't know about this, but to not include the butthole fact. But honestly, during my research, that never came up. Like, you were the first and last person I heard talk about that. I still haven't seen
proof. What's it say about me?
I haven't seen any proof of that whatsoever. But either way, we're looking for the fact from these five or four lies, one fact. Look for the fact.
Okay.
Starting with, because all the action was done CGI, the production budget saved money with no stunt doubles. All right. Number two, the tails and ears were the only cat parts that were done CGI. Cat parts, not the whole movie, just cat parts. Andrew Lloyd Webber, that's the guy that made the original movie. He had such a hard time dealing with the way his musical was portrayed on the screen that he got a therapy dog. And it was cats. Okay. Fourth one. Each crew member and actor were required to adopt a shelter cat as a promotion for the film. And the last one, my favorite one, because these names kill me. Mungo Jerry and Rumple Teaser are siblings in real life. The performers who played them.
Mm-hmm.
Mungo Jerry and Rumple Teaser.
Okay.
Okay. So, find it.
I know number two is bullshit because I would say their faces and their ears and their butts and their legs and everything was CGI. I don't know. Okay. Crew members required to adopt. That's something like Taylor Swift would probably be into now that I think about it. Siblings in real life. That's no stunt doubles. I'm going to listen to my heart and I'm going to say that Andrew Lloyd Webber got a therapy dog. Because the stunt double thing is clever, Bob. I'm just going to say this now. But even if it's CGI'd, if they're doing some sort of crazy gymnastics or jumping, it's still got to be somebody in that suit with the balls on it doing those moves. That's not the actor. So I'm going to say Andrew Lloyd Webber got a therapy dog, because I would venture to say people that are really into like song and dance and theater, I'm a musician, they're sensitive folks. And if you see your art getting mutilated, you're probably going to be traumatized by it, especially when there's a bunch of money and venture capital backing it and you have to go through with it despite your wishes. So I'm going to say he was probably traumatized by the whole production and got therapy.
Okay, I agree that he did. I just think the fact that he got a dog was Bob's little addition there.
Mm.
I'm going to go, and I'm hoping that I didn't ruin this for myself and cheat accidentally in bad credit names. I did not check out the Mungo Jerry and Rumple Teaser names specifically, but I do know that there is... at least three people with the same last name that I will not reveal, just a little foreshadowing for you until the catch-all. But I'm going to go with that because why not? They look enough alike. So I'm going to go with Mungo Jerry and Rumpelteazer are actual siblings.
All right. I meant to say they couldn't get stunt doubles with no assholes. That's what I meant to say.
Is that you really didn't like you? That wasn't the thing in your research? Like I remember like. The only reason I remember it is because I was like on Reddit, like when this movie came out, and like there was a whole uproar about the digitally removed assholes.
Well, it's funny you mentioned that because the guy I work with who also has a podcast, he said, "Hey, what's the episode this week?" I said, "Cats." He said, "Oh, the buttholes."
So it's lore. It's not just me. Got it.
It is not. So yeah, that was just today. So I didn't want to spoil it. Okay, so no, there were definitely stunt doubles. There were a lot of stunt doubles. There were like a shit ton of stunt doubles.
Yeah.
So that was not the fact. And here's a great fact. No part of their costumes were real.
Wow.
They had a little bit of makeup and then giant green suits.
You could tell, by the way, the face morphed into the rest of the...
Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
It looked weird.
And that the giant fur coat, you could see how the fur moved in a very unnatural way.
Yeah,
agreed.
I like Chris said it exactly right. I had a hard time keeping my eyes open.
Yeah, man, it was hard. I agree.
The shelter cat thing was a fun one to make up.
Yeah, I had a feeling. Okay. I'm starting to get to know you after seasons of bullshit.
But speaking of seasons of bullshit, a first: Rob wins, Chris loses.
Wow,
I was right.
Right. You were right. He actually got a therapy dog, and he went to get on an airplane, and with his dog, and they said, "Sorry, you can't take a dog on the plane." He says, "My therapy dog." They said, "We need to see paperwork," and he said, "I don't have paperwork." And then he explained that he made cats, and then the movie was based on, and they all said, "Oh, we saw that. You can have your dog on the plane."
Good for him.
Oh man.
So yeah, I think Chris, you're right. I read somewhere there's siblings, but I thought it was Mungo J. Rumpelteazer, and then when I looked it up, it is not at all.
Okay. Yeah, that well, I'm just glad that one of us got you.
Yeah, I'm
honestly glad. I feel like I'm glad. The entire team now.
Yeah. I'm happy for you. This is as the teacher in me. I want you to succeed. Nah.
Thank you. Give us a big red A+ for this week.
Yeah.
All right. Are you guys ready?
For the catch-all?
Yeah, because I'm going deep this time. I hate to say it. I'm going real deep into the theory behind this movie, the plot. I'm gonna really deep dive. So let's throw it to the catch-all.
We're only asking you to pick up what we're throwing down because you're not catching it in the first place. Welcome to the catch-all.
Okay, Here's a little one for you. It opens with, you know, big people dropping off the cat in a sack. It's Victoria. Then the other cats like rip the bag open. Cats out of the bag joke, right?
Yeah. I didn't catch that, but good.
Yeah. I don't do well with visual puns.
No.
You know, who knows? Maybe I don't either. I did catch that one.
Yeah.
Okay, we already mentioned it, so I'm just going to say it real fast. The human cat faces are puke-inducing. Next, the music sucks, mostly.
Yeah.
What was Idris Elba thinking?
Oh.
Okay, do cats practice musical numbers? or is it instinct? Because we kind of touched on this. Here's some of my deep dive material. Okay, you ready?
Yeah, let's do it.
Gus is a theater cat.
Yeah,
that's his. Yeah. That's his peculiar name. Apparently,
Asparagus.
Yeah, it was Asparagus. Yeah. He just like knew he was Asparagus.
That was horrible.
Oh my god, unbelievable! Yeah, good call, Bob. I didn't put that in. But magical Mr. Mistopheles asks him if he's nervous, and he replies by saying that he's practiced, and he's done it enough that he's not nervous, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then his performance is less involved than any of the other numbers, and it's about his current status, making practice less relevant, and it also kind of breaking a fourth wall, I don't know. I don't really understand, because if he practiced that, and it's like a to-the-moment, you know, it's not a rendition, it's a status report. It's like his soliloquy is like a Facebook post.
I'm not doing so hot.
Right. Yeah. And when do you practice that? And he, you know,
in the bathroom mirror at 3 a.m. with a hot dog, Chris. Have you learned nothing?
You know what I mean, though? This kind of like, I don't really understand why the cats are ready to hear him say this and where he would have performed this before. You know what I mean? It's less involved than any other number.
The rehearsal part is a point. It's a valid point. But I want to go back to your first point, which was, I think, a better point. This performance was so underwhelming. Yeah. Like if you're into ballet at all, this was an incredible movie for ballet. And they really put on some amazing performances.
They get,
And then he gets up and does a very quick monologue, and they, like, go nuts. Yeah.
Like it's a like turtle taking a shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a Shakespearean style theater performance that was way too short, and the only theatrics are the lightning that Mr. Mistopheles decided to add. You think? Improv. So, it just really bothered me. Let me rehearse the thing that I can only say now because it's current, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah,
it just doesn't make sense to me.
Yeah.
Unless he's always miserable and in a bad place.
See, I read it more like just like you get used to being on stage, or you get used to being performative, so it doesn't feel like a performance anymore.
That's what my wife was saying, and I didn't want to bring it up because that lessens my point. So
okay.
but also...
we're good for each other.
I felt like Gus needed some backup dancers, you know?
Yeah.
Like, he's the theater cat. He should have some... I don't know. For the convenience of exposition, this adult cat knows nothing about being a cat, even though Penny is a house cat, and she gets it.
Yeah.
So the cat that was a house cat is dropped off in the Jellicle Alley with the Jellicle cats that are doing the Jellicle Ball. And Penny, somehow, the house cat, who hasn't been pushed aside, is a Jellicle cat who understands what it's like to live that way. This other cat?
Are they Jellicles because they're angelical? I'm still hung up on.
No, Jellicle is just a made up word.
Okay.
Oh, and it's not. It's spelled with a J.
Jellicle, yeah.
Okay. Like jelly.
But was she a house cat, or was she like a baby that they didn't want?
Well, I guess I can't prove. They didn't show, or at least to my knowledge, they didn't show any like photos on the fireplace wall.
Yeah.
I only mentioned that because she seemed pretty ignorant to the entire world, not just Jellicle life.
Fair enough.
So maybe she was a baby.
Didn't she have a collar though?
I don't know.
I don't remember.
For a movie that spent about 58 minutes of exposition, they did a really shitty job explaining
it's unbelievable.
Where everybody came from and what they're doing.
Okay. Why is Penny wearing a cat fur suit outside of her dancing suit?
Hmm.
Which they call back later in the movie, which irritated me to no end.
Maybe right, they had
that's how
some.
They get out of the ropes.
Maybe there yeah. was some sort of ancient tribunal of like, in their world, cannibalistic dance-offs where like the victor got the spoils of war in the form of a fur coat of their opponent.
No.
Now you're thinking about it too hard, Rob.
Okay. Sorry.
No, this is. All right, so we're doing the classic check your bingo card, giving this movie too much credit. Yeah. But anyway, Rum Tum Tugger is a hot cat, right?
Yeah.
And he's got a foot, or I guess a paw fetish, but Victoria gives him her cat foot, which is a yeah. human foot, in like a, you know, a suit.
Mm-hmm.
Just thought I'd throw that out there. Why would there be a milk bar in a human world?
Yeah, I thought that right away.
Yeah.
Like everything else is human.
I know.
You know what, though? It reminded me of Tommy the Cat by Primus, and they had like a really cool milk bar in Les Claypool.
So, all right. Yeah, good point. This movie doesn't suck.
So for the 4 seconds they had that, and then I went back to letting the movie continue.
All right. Well, just to isolate one cat, for example, Rum Tum Tugger would have been a 3-foot-tall, bipedal, English-speaking, coat-wearing nightmare that can sing very nicely.
Yeah, imagine waking up and seeing that running from across your room towards you.
Oh my God. The plot. Okay, so here we go. The plot is that each musical number is led by the Jellicle cat using entertainment as a bid to be picked as the Jellicle choice so that they can be sent into the clouds to disappear. That's the plot of the movie.
That's about the size of it, yes.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
That's how they justify each musical number, as each cat is bidding to be the Jellicle choice so that they yeah. can be the ones that float in the hot air balloon into their death.
Yeah.
Okay. There are 2 magical cats.
Yep.
Yeah.
Not like card trick magic, like real magic.
Like David Blaine magic.
Yeah, like real stuff.
Yeah.
Like Chris Angel stuff.
Like, remember the masked magician on Fox that, like, probably got assassinated after filming all those secrets?
Oh, yeah.
Never mind.
Oh, really? I don't know of this. That sounds awesome.
He gave away all the magic.
There was a masked magician on Fox when it was still, like, trashy TV. And yeah. there were all these specials where he would just, like, debunk all the magic tricks and show you how they're done. But he never revealed his identity because, like, I'm sure, like, the Magicians Union would probably fucking have murdered him.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. That's a good point.
Yeah.
Mongo Jerry and Rumpelteazer wake up a dog, and the cat's team decided a dog would look too insane to show it.
Yeah.
What would a dog have looked like in this universe? I'd like to know.
I guess walking on 2 legs.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. It would have to be bipedal. And
yeah.
just dogs also can't talk because that would be crazy.
That'd be, that would totally make me suspend too much disbelief.
Right, yes. That would have a bridge too far.
Yeah.
Was old Deuteronomy's name ever just Deuteronomy?
point, counterpoint. He's named after the good book, so like maybe the original passages in the Bible were old Deuteronomy, and he is
because
he's old. No, I fucked it. Never mind. That joke didn't land. Just keep moving.
Yeah, it's a she too.
Yeah,
it's the old lady cat.
By the way, this is the only the first time it was ever portrayed as a female.
Oh, okay. Well, there you go, Rob.
In every stage production ever, it was a
yeah,
man.
See, I'm such a big fan of the original, I just forgot.
You know?
Well, I assumed when they mentioned Old Deuteronomy at first that it would be a man.
Yeah.
Because it doesn't sound like a woman's name. But, you know, these days, you can never be certain.
Some they-them action in there, I'd say.
Yeah, there's definitely some them. And, and we're,
dude,
you know,
it's dude yeah. Deuteronomy.
Deuterino.
Oh, damn, you just stole a joke.
Oh.
Why does she get to choose? Doesn't that seem like kind of a dictatorship? Like, what if it's something we're all after, why wouldn't she just put herself in the hot air balloon?
That's a good point.
Especially because she's old.
Yeah.
I wrote, and I already mentioned him, but no, Ian McKellen, what are you doing? No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's an enormous dance routine with no singing and no other source of music. Yeah. So for us, there's music, but for them, there wouldn't be. So they do like a 15-minute, dance with no sound.
It gave me the vibe. You ever see like when someone like they get like the Grubhub commercial or like the Kroger commercial when they're like fucking like dancing and they like remove the music and add like the foot scuffle sounds?
Yeah.
That's exactly what I'm going for here.
That's exactly right.
Yeah, that's what I was
like,
thinking.
In their world, it's like a hip number, but like to people just walking by it, they're like, what the fuck are they doing?
Yeah, there's another one too where there's people in like a virtual reality club. So everybody's like wearing the headsets, but like in the actual club, it's just like sneakers. Like,
Gathering of the Vibes 2011, they had a silent rave and it was exactly that. And I did it.
Well, how was it?
Everybody just like put their earbuds in and they were just like going like this to lights.
Wow.
Okay. And then,
did you enjoy yourself?
Well, I walked by and said, what the hell is that? That's stupid. And someone told me what it was. And I was like, okay, I have to do that. And then I did it. And then that was the extent of it.
Okay.
Yeah. It was it was like day four at 3 a.m. So it was dumb.
Well, so how many hot dogs were you passing around?
Fairground prices at that point in any festival, as we all know, I'm not spending $14 on a hot dog.
Dude, you should have had some raw Oscar Mayer strapped to your back under your shirt.
Armor hot dog.
Just handing out those back alley glizzies on the floor.
Back alley glizzies.
Okay, so Memories is borderline emotionally moving. I actually I found some of the lyrical content of Memories to be actually kind of gripping, and I was hating myself for that, but that's the best it gets.
That's incredibly backhanded too. It's borderline emotionally moving. Like, it's not even emotionally moving.
Gus plays for 30 cats and they get in for free.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Again, he never played the Egyptian before.
Yeah.
I just thought it was funny to see this like renowned cat actor performing for so little. Crowd wise and penny wise.
Yeah.
His name is Gus the Theater Cat. Gus doesn't seem like the third particular peculiar name to me. We already mentioned this, but as you said, Bob, it's a spirit. So good on you. The most satisfying 2 minutes in the movie, in my opinion, is Skimble Shanks and his tap dance routine.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, that was nice.
Yeah, I thought that was kind of cool. What happens when Deuteronomy dies?
I'm guessing they go back to the death match. And they skin a new cat and make a new coat for the new emperor.
The old no asshole arena.
Yeah.
How often is the Jellicle choice made, I'd like to know. Did they say?
Oh, if they did, I missed it.
I feel like they said once a year, but boy, I don't know for sure.
Yeah. Well, I don't either, but it makes me wonder where they're getting a disappearing hot air balloon once every year. Then.
I don't know.
That's a good point. Things where they're like trying to explain how cats can do all of this stuff and have like a local economy with no money, and they'd have to commission humans to build that hot air balloon that's also a chandelier that can disappear.
Or they're hippies and they gave them like a bag of homemade Kahlua in exchange for their services to make a balloon.
True. True.
Yeah.
Or
Jennifer Hudson, she's got some pipes.
She does.
Yeah.
Thought I'd throw that out there. I was like, damn, that's really good. Really good singing you did there. Why can't old dude pick herself? I wrote, but I kind of already spoiled that because Bob already spoiled the joke.
Oh, bingo.
Okay, and lastly, it took the outsider cat to show the performing cats that the person who needed the Jellicle revival the most was the one who was shunned. This is an attempt at story writing. But it's too loose on both ends. It's not tied to anything. Anyway.
It
did
is,
you
yeah.
feel it was introduced just a little too late? That whole.
Can you explain further? I'd like to hear more of that.
Sean the Cat like didn't like have a super prominent role until like.
Oh, I see what you mean. Okay.
The ham-fistedness of the third act.
Yeah, it really did get ham-fisted there, didn't it?
Yeah.
I agree. Mm-hmm.
But you're right, though. They never explained why she was so shunned in the first place, and that made me care about her way less.
Something about her running with McCavity or something.
Yeah.
Aren't they all homeless?
Yeah, that's what I was saying before. Bob, like, I don't understand.
They're fucking cats.
Yeah. They're all homeless.
Yeah.
I really don't think I don't think the balloon is real. I think all the catnip just made them envision that's what happened.
Okay, well that would explain how they have a balloon in the first
place. Do you think this is just like a furry convention on an ether frolic and they just filmed it?
I think they dumped her in the water, she sank to her death, but they imagined that she floated away to a new life.
And then they were like, now we don't have to feed her any scraps.
Yeah.
That homeless piece of shit.
I feel like this is an elaborate way to control the pet population.
Yeah.
Yes. Have your pet spayed and neutered.
Yeah, Bob Barker at the end, right? Was Bob Barker? Yeah.
Any more mentions before Rob's alternate ending?
No. Yeah.
Okay, Rob, take it away.
Yes, actually.
Oh.
Taylor Swift speaks very fondly of her experience on the set. And I did some digging. After that, I Googled, is Taylor Swift actually really nice in person? And everybody overwhelmingly says yes. And she said that you can't, when you're part of a project and you're that close to it, if like the people are kind to you and you have a good time on the set, that's all your experience is. You can't really bank on whether or not people are like it. And I found that interesting. So that's kind of wholesome.
That's a positive way to think, and good on her. Maybe it was all the catnip she was drenched in for hours.
Yeah. And she's like, nepotism. She's like, I know all these Broadway people and I could use that. So like also that.
Hey, fair enough.
All right.
Damn.
Take it away. You can do this or you can do that. Or you can do this or you can do that. Or you can do this or you can do
that. Just pick one. Euthanasia. All right, bad credit names.
Bad credit names. Bad credit names. Bad credit names.
Bob warned me about the bad credit names this week. Okay. You know why? Because there were 4,000 names on this project.
Is this like that Creed video?
What's that?
There's a Creed video that's all CGI, and like the reports on it were that like they spent like thousands of man hours trying to meet the deadline, and just knowing that like some dude didn't get to spend Christmas with his family so Scott Stapp could like have a sword is amazing.
Do you know that I just saw him at Oyster Fest?
Like perform?
Yes.
Awesome.
Scott Stapp did Oyster Fest in Milford.
Yeah, I mean, he's in the state fair circuit now. I'd say Jim Blossoms always do it, like Spin Doctors, all those kind of bands.
Yeah, I mean, Blue Oyster Cult was at the Oyster Festival. Believe it or not. It's a funny coincidence. Yeah. You're at that level. You know what he played the whole time?
The Marlins song, We Will Soar?
No, it was all Creed shit.
Oh, was it? Okay.
Yeah, I was surprised. I didn't think he'd have the right to use it. Maybe he wrote the songs.
He has he does a song called We Will Soar, and it's on a solo record, but they had him redo it for like the team, the Marlins. And he's like, strike one, strike two, stealing a base.
It's actually like, oh my god, I'm YouTubing that.
I'll send it to you after. Yeah.
Immediately after I look up Cat Vocals.
Okay.
I'm looking that up. All right. So the reason I say that there's a million names is because I could not keep up. I wasn't going to sit there and read them for an hour. I'm sorry. I'm just not doing
that's
it.
Fine.
Podcast will be fun. All right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Andy Black and Bluer.
Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Bluey Robinson.
Okay.
Poling Tongue.
All right.
Okay.
Lupt Atuma.
Ew.
Ah.
L-U-P-T.
That's lump. Cancerous. Lump a tumor.
Yeah, pretty much. Sousa Grundy.
Ew.
Mm.
Naga Sundeep.
Okay.
Sundeep.
Yeah, I kind of like Naga Sundeep. It was Sundeep.
Yeah, I've noticed Sundeep.
Yeah, okay. I had to write this one in because it's our first reference to South Park Met Towley.
Oh, you want to get high.
Towley. Cool last name. Okay, here's why I thought maybe the Rumpel teaser and Mungo Jerry kids were twins or whatever. It's because we had three people with the same last name, and I'm going to give you all of their first names first because they're the winner. They tie for first.
Okay.
Rebecca, Larry, and Lee Gooch. G-O-O-C-H.
That's Gooch. Fucking gross.
That just sucks.
Speaking of South Park, Cartman, one of his dolls is Rumpertumpkins.
And, yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
Oh.
And then he got a doll of Muscle Man Mark. And in real life, Muscle Man Mark got a Rumpertumpkin tattoo. And then next time they showed Muscle Man Mark, the doll on South Park had a Rumpertumpkin tattoo on it.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Huh.
How about that?
Yeah. It's like a picture.
Well, there's our weekly South Park segment. Yeah. So on to movie comparison.
This is gonna be probably a clean sweep. I don't know.
Well, we'll have to see. But I got to give it to the song there, the little bumper, because nothing compares to Cats in my opinion.
Yeah.
Even if there are worse movies out there, nothing compares to this.
Yeah.
Hocus Pocus 2 versus Cats, starting with the worst of its kind, -25 and worst. Decent score from Hocus Pocus 2, but as you might remember, a -67.6 and worst of its kind from Cats.
Yeah, that's fair.
Clear winner there. I'm not going to call that one a wash.
Numbers don't lie.
Okay, Rob, it can't be a sweep. You know why? Because we gave Chris a 5-star pitch last week. And now, the higher the star grade, the worse the movie, with a 4.25 star and another Chris victory, I might add. Cats does not clean sweep. It's 1-1 headed into dialogue. What do you think was worse? It's Cats.
Yeah, no, I will fault Cats.
Yes.
On that.
Okay, cool.
It was worse.
Well, I don't know who's winning this one. The worst production for Hocus Pocus 2 was Let Sleeping Dogs Lie. A reference to the fact that this should never have been redone. Hocus Pocus 2 should not have been a remake. And then Cats is too much CGI. What's worse?
I mean, I'm gonna go. It's hard to say something shouldn't be made at all, and that's because that's gonna be worse from a global standpoint because the whole thing's a piece of shit. But if you're gonna remake or if you're gonna make a Broadway musical into a movie, don't do it like this.
Agreed.
Yeah, so. it was unnerving. Like I've seen some pretty Chris. Bob, we grew up with Faces of Death and Rotten.com.
Oh, yeah.
And I got to say, I walked away from the 2019 version of Cats feeling like not the same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right. It's hard to take anything in and feel anything anymore, thanks to those sites. But this certainly made me feel like that really effective horror movie feeling. When you go to sleep and you think there's a shadow in the corner of your room, all I saw was Rum Tum Tugger running across the floor.
I need to just quickly mention that the one guy, one jar.
Yeah, one guy, one jar. Yeah.
He briefly came back like a month ago on TikTok.
Did he?
And you know when they do like the glow ups where like they swing their foot in front of the camera and they pull them out and their wardrobe's changed?
Yes. You
know, it's just his legs and they're like, do you remember me? And he does that, and he's naked from the waist down in his jar.
Oh, no.
And then he got banned like a week later.
Well, he could have been cast in Cats because I think he also no longer has an asshole. So. Yeah. All right, enough butthole jokes. All right, we'll give Rob the sec.
I'm good.
I'm going to skip offensive so we can do the mini game, which is not going to be crazy this week, but hopefully we'll get a couple laughs. What acting was worse? I'm going to have to go Hocus Pocus 2 here.
Yes, and the reason I have for this is it's hard to fault the acting ability of people in a musical, because if they're singing the number and they're doing the moves, then they did their part.
Yeah.
Acting while singing and dancing is a challenge. So, and they rose to it enough.
I agree. So we went with too much CGI for production, right? I don't know that we said that solidly.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. All right. So we have the demerit section we're going to do first. I think it's an absolute wash because it's essentially the same thing. The no future jokes really landed for Hocus Pocus 2.
Yeah.
And the source divergent jokes of raunch and fat didn't land either. So I say we don't count those. Wash.
Yeah, it's a wash.
I can live with that.
Cool. All right. Well, let's find out what's more offensive.
All right.
The head to toe sniff up.
Okay.
Or eating the enslaved.
Eating the enslaved.
Oh, I guess eating the enslaved. I didn't think about that. Yeah.
Assaulting apple bobbers. Or the ginormous register of Jellicles.
Well, the apple bobbers was, what was that, like trying to drown them?
Essentially.
Playfully, yes.
Playfully drowning.
Playful child drowning.
I used to hate when my brother would hold my head underwater as a kid, so yeah.
Yeah, my sister, I was taking a bath when I was younger, and my sister just came in with her foot, just put it on my head and pushed it underwater.
Yeah.
And I just had a half a minute there of struggle, but I'm still here.
Yeah.
Okay, it's 1-1, headed into the bonus round, guys, good job.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to reverse it. Cats first this time. Fat jokes.
Okay.
Or Jason Mewes.
It's fat jokes.
Fat jokes. Because you know
okay,
what?
Okay, fine.
Fat jokes are kind of old hat, but like you can make them funny. Like, I'm thinking Al Bundy. I'm thinking Al Bundy.
Yeah.
Like, oh, the sitting there peg and the sweater hog came into. Like, it's just funny. I don't know. It makes me laugh.
All right. Well, I mean, it wasn't a clean sweep, but we did get a Cats victory at 4-2. Demerits a walk. So the worst movie of the season, maybe ever made, is Cats. I found this movie to be absolutely atrocious. Any closing words before we send our audience out?
This director won an Oscar for Best Picture.
Huh.
Wow.
For this movie or for a different movie?
No.
The King's Speech.
Okay.
Oh, the King's Speech.
Oh, that's fair.
And did that come out the next year?
And he no, it came out like years earlier, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah. I remember it. It feels recent.
Not as recent as this. This was barely pre-pandemic.
Yeah, that's right.
I saw King's Speech in the theater. Actually, he's only the third director in history to win a Best Picture and a Razzie for Worst Picture.
Wow.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Yep. That's my last word.
Rob?
TheWorstMovieEverMade.com. Are we playing out with a clip?
Let's play it out with a clip.
This is called Mice.
Buzz! When the day's hustle and bustle is done, then the Gumby Cat's work is but hardly begun. And when all the families in bed and asleep, I tuck up my skirts to the basement to creep. I am deeply concerned with the ways of the mice. Their behavior's not good, and their manners not nice. So when I have got them lined up on the matting, I teach them music, crocheting, and scratching. Dinner and a show.
All right, sorry. That just reminded me of Cat in the Hat.
Yeah.
Just there on the tail end. The performative mice. Mm-hmm. And I just thought it was a weird coincidence that one of our other least favorites of all time was an animated cat who sang and danced and did a terrible job with bad CGI. Okay, that's all I have to say.
Let's go home. That was fast.